These are the holy Vedas, the most sacred. And there are principally four Vedas. We have the Rig Veda, which deals with the songs of praises. We have the Yajur Veda, which deals with the sacrificial formulas. We have the Sam Veda, which deals with melody. And the Atharva Veda, which deals with magical formulas. Vedas are the most authentic and the most sacred among the Hindu scriptures. And these Vedas, the exact date when they were written or when they were revealed is not known. According to Swami Dayanand Saraswati of Arya Samaj, he says that the Vedas are 1310 million years old. But according to the majority of the scholars, they say that the Vedas are approximately 4000 years old. The exact date is not known. To whom it was revealed or who compiled it is not known. Where it came into existence the first time in the world, it's not known. But yet, the Vedas are considered to be of divine origin, the word of God, and they are the most sacred amongst all the Hindu scriptures. Next we have the Upanishads. There are more than 200 Upanishads, but our Indian culture puts a figure of approximately 100 in it. And there are some important Upanishads. Some say 10, some say 12, some say 18. This Upanishad, which is translated by Radha Krishna, he says there are 18 principal Upanishads. Next, we have the Smritis. Smriti means memory, that which is remembered. And these Smritis, they are less authentic, less sacred as compared to the Shrutis, the Vedas and Upanishads. And they are not of divine origin. The Hindu scholars say they have been written by men for the guidance of the human being, how a life should be led. They are also referred as the Dharma Shastra. Among the Smriti, we have the Itihas, the epics. We have the two great epics, Ramayana and Mahabharata. Ramayana is an epic which deals with the story of Sri Ram, which most of us Indians, we are aware of it. Then we have the Mahabharata. Mahabharata talks about a feud between the cousins, the Pandavas and the Kauravas. It also deals with the story of Sri Krishna, and all of us are aware about the story of Mahabharata. Then we have the Bhagavad Gita. It is an advice given by Sri Krishna to Arjun in the battlefield, and it is a part of Mahabharata. It contains 18 chapters from the Bhishma Parva of Mahabharata, from chapter number 25 to chapter number 42. It contains totally 18 chapters. Next, amongst the Hindu scriptures, we have the Puranas. We deal with the stories of deities, the creation of the universe. It is compiled into 18 voluminous parts by Maharishi Vyas. And most important amongst the Puranas is the Bhavishya Purana. This is the Bhavishya Purana, which talks about the future. There are various other scriptures of the Hindus. We cannot name all. Another one is the Manusmriti, the laws of the Hindus, which are written by Manu. So in short, these were the scriptures, the books of Hinduism. But the major are the Vedas. If anything contradicts with the Vedas should be followed. They are the most sacred amongst all the Hindu scriptures, and they are considered to be of divine origin. Let's discuss the books in Islam. It's mentioned in Surah Ra'd, chapter number 13, verse number 38. It says, وَلِكُلِّ أَجْلٍ كِتَابٍ. In every age have we sent a revelation. There were several revelations sent by Almighty God on this earth. But the last and final revelation is the glorious Quran. And it is the most sacred amongst all the Islamic scriptures. It was revealed to the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, 1400 years ago, it was revealed in Arabic. And Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Shuara, chapter number 26, verse number 196, that it is assuredly mentioned in the revealed books of the previous people. That means Quran is mentioned in the revealed books of all the previous people. The other sacred books are the authentic hadith, the traditions and the sayings of the last and final messenger Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. These are supplementary to the Quran. They are a commentary of the Quran. They will never conflict with the Quran. They will never overrule the Quran. This is Sahih Bukhari, which is one of the authentic books, the sayings of the Prophet. Fourth pillar of Iman is the messengers of God. First, we'll discuss the messengers of God in Islam. Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Fatir, chapter number 35, verse number 24, وَإِمْ مِنْ أُمَّةٍ إِلَّا خَلَافِيَا نَزِيرٍ. There is not a people without a warner having lived amongst them in the past. Allah says in the Quran that there were several messengers sent on the face of the earth. He also says in Surah Ahzab, chapter number 33, verse number 40, مَا كَانَ مُحَمَّدٌ أَبَا أَهْدٍ مِرْجَالِكُمْ وَلَاكِ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ وَخَاتَمَ النَّبِيِّينَ وَكَانَ اللَّهُ بِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ عَلِيمًا. Which means, Muhammad, peace be upon him, is not the father of any of you men, but he is a messenger of Allah, and he is the seal of the prophets. He is the last and the final messenger of Almighty God. And Allah is all-knowing, full of knowledge. Since Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, was the last and final messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he was not sent only for the Muslims or only for the Arabs. Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Anbiya, chapter number 21, verse number 107, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةَ لِلْعَالَمِينَ. That we have sent thee not but as a mercy to the whole of humanity, as a mercy to all the worlds, as a mercy to all creatures. The message is repeated in Surah Sabah, chapter number 34, verse number 28, where Allah says, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا كَفَّةً لِلنَّاسِ بَشِيرًا وَنَزِيرًا. That we have sent thee not but as a universal messenger, giving glad tidings and warning them against sin. But most of the human beings yet do not know. And a prophet said, it's mentioned in Sahih Bukhari, volume number 1, in the book of Salah, chapter number 56, hadith number 429. The prophet said that all the previous messengers that came before me, they were only sent for their people, but I have been sent for the whole of humanity. Let's discuss the concept of messengers in Hinduism. The common Hindus, they have a different concept. They believe in avatars. The word avatar is derived from av, which means down, and tra, which means Passover. So avatar means to descend down, to come down. And according to Oxford Dictionary, it says that avatar means, in Hindu mythology, a deity or a revered soul coming down on the earth in bodily form. The common Hindus, they believe that avatar means Almighty God coming on this earth as a human being. And this concept, they derive from Bhagavad Gita, chapter number 4, verse number 7 and 8, which says, Yada yada hi dharmasya glanir bhavati bharata abhyutaranam dharmasya tatatmanam shrajyamayam. It's a very common verse. We hear it on the television in the serial of Mahabharata, which means that whenever there is decay of religion, O Bharata, and rise of unrighteousness, I manifest myself, verse number 8 says, to protect the good and for the destruction of the evil, and to establish righteousness, I will be born in every age. Sambhavami yuge yuge. I will be born in every age. This message is also repeated in the Bhagavad Purana, Khand 9, Adhyay 24, Shloka 56. It says, that whenever there is decay of righteousness and rise of sinfulness, I incarnate myself. But this concept of avatar, which most of the common Hindus believe in, it is nowhere to be found in the Vedas, the most sacred amongst all the Hindu scriptures. Therefore, the scholars of Veda, they say that the concept of avatar as believed by the common Hindu is different, because avatar is a Sanskrit word which is possessive of Almighty God. It doesn't mean God Almighty has come himself down. It is possessive, therefore it refers to a man who Almighty God has sent. And if you read the Vedas, nowhere in the Vedas is the concept of avatar present. But the Vedas speak about saintly men, about rishis who Almighty God has sent to guide the humankind. This is exactly the same as the Islamic concept that Almighty God chooses a man amongst men and communicates with them on a higher level. And these men who Allah has sent to guide the human beings are called as messengers or prophets of Almighty God. So if you consider the Vedic concept, it is similar to the Islamic concept that Almighty God has sent chosen men who we call as prophets or messengers. Let's discuss what do the Hindu scriptures have to speak about the last and final prophet, the Antim Rishi. It's mentioned in the Bhavishya Purana, Parva 3, Khanda 3, Adhyay 3, Shlokas 10 to 27, it says that the Malaychas have spoiled the land of the Arabs. There is an enemy who's causing mischief. I will send a man by the name of Muhammad to defeat this enemy and to guide the people. O Raja, you need not go to the foolish land of Pishachas. I, with my grace, will purify you here. A person of angelic disposition comes to Raja and says, Arya Dharma will prevail in the world. The religion of truth will prevail in the world. I have been sent by Ishwar Paramatma, and my followers will be those who will be circumcised, who will not have a shendi, a tail on the head. They will grow a beard. They will create a revolution. They will give the call for prayers. They will eat all lawful things, but will not eat the flesh of swine. They will not be purified by herbs or shrubs, but will be purified by warfare. They will be called Muslims. They will be a creed of meat eaters. Now this prophecy, if we analyze, refers to no one but the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. It says that the enemies will be defeated by a man called as Muhammad. His name is mentioned, peace be upon him. And he will guide the people. And we know Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam led the Arabs from darkness to light. It further says that the followers of this prophet, referring to the Muslims, they will be people who are circumcised. They will not have a tail on the head. They will grow a beard. They will create a revolution. They will give the call for prayer, that the azan. They will eat all lawful things, but will not eat the flesh of swine. They will not be purified by herbs and shrubs, but by warfare. They will be called Muslims. They will be a community of meat eaters. All these prophesies no one but Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, and his followers, the Muslims. Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, has been prophesied in several places in Bhavishya Purana. Time doesn't permit us to go into the details. I'll just give a reference of a couple. He's prophesied in Bhavishya Purana, Parva 3, Khanda 3, Adhyay 3, Shlokas 5 to 8. He's also prophesied in Bhavishya Purana, Parva 3, Khand 1, Adhyay 3, Shlokas 21 to 23. The Prophet Muhammad has even been prophesied in several places in the Atharva Ved. It's mentioned in Atharva Ved, book number 20, hymn number 127, shlokas 1 to 14. These are called as the Kuntup Suktas. Kuntup in Sanskrit means the hidden gland in the abdomen. Referring to the meanings of the shlokas are hidden, they will be known later on. Due to shortage of time, we'll just discuss the first four in brief. The first mantra says, he will be Narashansa. He will be Kaurama. He will be protected from 60,090 enemies. Mantra number 2 says, he will be a camel riding Rishi. Mantra number 3 says, he will be Mama Rishi. Mantra number 4 says, he is Vashves Reb. The first mantra says, he is Narashansa. Narashansa in Sanskrit, it derived from the word Nar, meaning a man or a person, and Shansa means praiseworthy. How we know in Hindi we say Prashansa? So Shansa is the same thing. So Narashansa means a person who is praiseworthy. And if you translate Muhammad, peace be upon him, from Arabic to English, it means the praiseworthy. So Narashansa is the Sanskrit translation of the Arabic word Muhammad, peace be upon him. The first mantra further says, he is Kaurama. One of the meaning of Kaurama, it means the Prince of Peace. And the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, was the Prince of Peace. The other meaning of Kaurama is an immigrant. And the Prophet migrated from Makkah to Medina. And the verse also says, he will defeat 60,090 enemies. And we know the population of Makkah, that was against Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, was approximately 60,000. Mantra number 2 says, he will be a camel riding Rishi, indicating he will not be an Indian Rishi, he will not be a Brahmin. Because Manusmriti, chapter number 11, verse number 202 says, a Brahmin cannot ride a camel or an ass. So this means it cannot be an Indian Rishi, it cannot be a Brahmin, it has to be a foreign Rishi, a foreigner. Mantra number 3 says, he is Mama Rishi, also meaning Maharishi, means a great Rishi. Or some places it says Muhammad, that is the name of Prophet Muhammad. The fourth mantra says, he is Reb. Reb means one who praises. Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, he was also called as Ahmad, may peace be upon him, which means one who praises. And the Prophet was called the one who praises, which is the translation of the Sanskrit word Reb. He has been prophesied in several other places in the Atharva Ved. He is also prophesied in Atharva Ved, book number 20, hymn number 21, verse number 6. It says that Akaru, meaning the praiseworthy man, he will defeat 10,000 enemies without a battle. This refers to the battle of Ahzab, battle of Khandaq, which Prophet Muhammad, we know that he was the one who was praiseworthy. And he won the battle of Khandaq, battle of Ahzab, in which the enemies were approximately 10,000 without the battle being fought. He is also prophesied in Atharva Ved, book number 20, hymn number 21, verse number 7, saying that the Abandhu, by God's help, will defeat 20 chiefs. Abandhu means an orphan. It also means one who praises. Both of this refer to Prophet Muhammad. And he will defeat 20 chiefs. We know from history that approximately in Makkah, there were approximately 20 tribes. So Prophet Muhammad, he won the battle of Makkah and defeated all these 20 chiefs. Prophet Muhammad is even prophesied in Rig Ved, book number 1, hymn number 53, verse number 9. The same prophecy, but the word is changed. It's called as Sushrama. And Sushrama again means one who praises, the translation of the word Muhammad. The Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is also prophesied in the Psalm Ved in Agni Mantra number 64. It says that he will not be fed by his mother. His mother will not breastfeed him. And after that, he'll become a prophet. And we know it was Arab custom that the children are normally breastfed by the wet nurse. And Prophet Muhammad, he was breastfed by Halima. May Allah be pleased with her. There are various prophecies of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, in several places in the Vedas. He is also prophesied in Psalm Ved, in Uttarchik, mantra number 1500. It says that Ahmad will be given the eternal law. Ahmad, as I mentioned earlier, is another name for Prophet Muhammad, meaning one who praises. he will be given the eternal law, referring to the Quran. Some way says he has been given the eternal law. But since Ahmad is a non-Sanskrit word, the translators could not understand what is the meaning of Ahmad. So they broke the word into Eh and Meti. And now they translate as I alone. So it means I alone have been given eternal law. So if you read the translation, it says I alone have been given the eternal law. But actually it should read as Ahmad has been given the eternal law. And Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam has been prophesied as Ahmad in several places in the Vedas. He's also prophesied in the Vedas in some way, in Indra, mantra number 152. He's prophesied in Yajurved, chapter number 31, verse number 18. He's prophesied in Rigved, book number 8, hymn number 6, verse number 10. In Atharvaved, book number 8, hymn number 5, verse number 16. In Atharvaved, book number 20, hymn number 126, verse number 14. In several places, he has been prophesied as Ahmad, which was another name of Prophet Muhammad, the one who praises. Furthermore, the last and final messenger has been prophesied as Narashansa in several places in the Vedas. As I mentioned earlier, Narashansa is derived from the word Nar, meaning a person or man, and Shansa as Prashansa means a praiseworthy, a man who's praiseworthy, which is exactly the translation of the Arabic word Muhammad. Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, has been prophesied as Narashansa, as Muhammad, peace be upon him, in several places in the Vedas. He's prophesied in Rigved, book number 1, hymn number 13, verse number 3. In Rigved, book number 1, hymn number 18, verse number 9. In Rigved, book number 1, hymn number 106, verse number 4. In Rigved, book number 1, hymn number 142, verse number 3. In Rigved, book number 2, hymn number 3, verse number 2. In Rigved, book number 5, hymn number 5, verse number 2. In Rigved, book number 7, hymn number 2, verse number 2. In Rigved, book number 10, hymn number 64, verse number 3. In Rigved, book number 10, hymn number 182, verse number 2. In Yajurved, chapter number 20, verse number 37. Yajurved, chapter number 20, verse number 57. Yajurved, chapter number 21, verse number 31. Yajurved, chapter number 21, verse number 55. Yajurved, chapter number 28, verse number 2. Yajurved, chapter number 28, verse number 19. Yajurved, chapter number 28, verse number 42. You can keep on quoting only references. He's been mentioned as Narashansa in several places in the Vedas. You can only give a talk for several hours together about Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, mentioned in the Hindu scriptures. I'll just mention another one last prophecy. He has been prophesied as the Kalki Avatar, the final Avatar, the Antim Rishi. It's mentioned in the Puranas about the Kalki Avatar, about his coming. It's mentioned in the Bhagavata Purana, Khand 12, Adhyay 2, Shlokas 18 to 20. It says that in the house of Vishnu Yash, the revered priest, Brahmin priest, of the village of Sambhala will be born the Kalki Avatar. It further says that he will be Lord of the worlds and he will have unsurpassed qualities and character. He will be given specially 8 criteria. And he will be given by the angels a steed horse, a fleet horse. And he will ride a white horse with the sword in his hand. He will defeat the miscreant, the evil people. And he will be savior to the world. It further says in Bhagavad Purana, Khand 1, Adhyay 3, Shloka 25, that in Kali Yuga, where kings become robbers, there will be a savior who will be born in the house of Vishnu Yash. His name shall be Kalki. He is even prophesied in the Kalki Purana, chapter number 2, verse number 4, that in the house of Vishnu Yash, the chief of the village of Sambhala will be born Kalki Avatar. Kalki Purana, chapter number 2, verse number 5, says that he will, along with 4 companions, defeat the evil people Kalki Purana, chapter number 2, verse number 7 says that he will be helped by the angels in the battlefield. Kalki Purana, chapter number 2, verse number 11 says that in the house of Vishnu Yash, in the womb of Sumati, the Kalki Avatar will be born. And further says in Kalki Purana, chapter number 2, verse number 15, that he will be born on the 12th of the first half of the month of Madhav. Now all these prophecies refer to no one but the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Point number 1, he will be born in the house of Vishnu Yash. That means his father's name will be Vishnu Yash. And we know that the name of the father of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was Abdullah. Vishnu Yash means the follower, the obedient of Vishnu. And Abdullah means the obedient, the worshipper of Almighty God. His mother's name will be Sumati. Sumati in Sanskrit means one who's peaceful. And the name of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam's mother was Amina, which also means peaceful. It says he will be born in the village by the name of Sambala. Sambala in Arabic means a place which is of peace and security. And we know Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was born in Makkah, which is also called as Darul Aman, which means a place of security and peace. It further says that he will be born in the house of the chief of Sambala. And we know Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was born in the house of the chief of Makkah. It further says he will be born on the 12th day of the first half of the month of Madhav. And we know that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was born on the 12th of the first half of the month of Rabbi Awwal. It further says that the Kalki Avatar, he will be an Antim Rishi, the last Rishi. And we know Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was the last and final messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as is mentioned in Surah Ahzab, chapter 33, verse number 40. It further says that he will receive guidance from Parshuram in the mountain, and then he'll go towards the north and come back. We know he received the first guidance through Archangel Gabriel in Gar Hira in Jabal Nur, that is the mountain of light. And later he migrated from Makkah, that is northwards, and he comes back to Makkah later. It further says that he will have qualities which are unsurpassed in character, as Allah says in the Quran in chapter number 68, verse number 4. It says that verily thou art standeth on the highest standard of character. Thou art standeth on the highest standard of character. It further says that this Kalki Avatar will be given 8 special qualities, referring to he will be wise, he'll have self-control, he'll have respectable lineage, he will also have revealed knowledge, he'll have valor and strength, he will have measured speech, he will have the qualities of being charitable, and he will also be very kind. All these 8 criteria and characteristics refer to no one but the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. It fits his character exactly. It further says that Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, he will be given the steed horse by Shiva. And we know Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was given the buraq by Almighty God, by which he went to Miraj, the ascension to heaven. It further says he will ride a white horse and will have the sword in the right hand. We know that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he took part in most of the battles, most of which were in self-defense. He took active part, he even rode the horse and had the sword in the right hand. It further says that he will be a savior of humankind, as Allah says in the Quran in Surah Fatir, chapter number 35, verse number 24, and Surah Sabah, chapter number 34, verse number 28. It says, "Wama arsalnaka," that we have sent thee not but as a mercy to the whole of humankind. And he has been sent as a guidance to the whole humankind. but most of the men yet do not know. He's also said that he will guide the people to the right path. And we know Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, it was the days of Yawm al-Jahiliya, and he guided them from darkness to light. It further says that he will be supported by four companions who will spread the message. And we know the four companions mentioned refer to Hazrat Abu Bakr, Hazrat Umar, Hazrat Usman, and Hazrat Ali, may Allah be pleased with them all. And it further says that he will be helped by the angels in the battlefield. And we know in the battle of Badr, angels helped Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam to win the battle. It's mentioned in the Quran, in Surah Al-Imran, chapter number 3, verse 123 and 125. It's also mentioned in chapter number 8, verse number 8 and 9. These prophecies undoubtedly refer to no one but the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. He's been referred as the last Rishi, Antim Rishi, the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Let's discuss the fifth pillar of Iman, that is believing in life after death, believing in the hereafter. First, we'll discuss life after death in Hinduism. The common Hindu, he believes in the cycle of birth, death, and rebirth, known as samsara, the theory of reincarnation. And this theory of reincarnation says that Almighty God has created different people in different ways. Some are born rich, some are born poor, some are born healthy, some are born with some congenital defect. So how could God be unjust in making different people born different ways? So they came out with the theory of samsara, also known as theory of reincarnation or transmigration of soul, based on the verse of Bhagavad Gita, chapter number 4, verse number 22, which says, whenever a person changes his clothes and wears new clothes, it is somewhat similar, like a soul gives away the body and enters new body. It believes in the theory of karma. The actions that you do are the karma. If you do good actions, you'll be rewarded in this world or the hereafter. If you do bad actions, you'll get a punishment. They also believe in the theory of dharma. Dharma means a person should live life according to the guidance of Almighty God. If you do good dharma, then your karma also will be good. And they believe in moksha, that means free from the cycle of birth, death, and rebirth. If you analyze that this concept of transmigration of soul or samsara is nowhere mentioned in the Vedas. What the Vedas speak is about the punarjanam. Punar means next or again. Janam means life. So punarjanam means next life or life again. It doesn't mean life, death, and life again. It's not cycle of birth, death, and rebirth. It's only next life or life again. So the Hindu scholars who believe in the Vedas, they say that the concept of transmigration of soul was never mentioned in the Vedas. It came into existence later on. What is mentioned in the Vedas, if you read Rig Ved, book number 10, hymn number 16, verse number 4 and 5, it speaks about the next life and also says you will go to paradise, but doesn't speak about death, life, and death. Further, if you analyze the Vedas and the other Hindu scriptures, they talk about swarg, about heaven, and describes heaven that it is a very beautiful place where rivers will flow, there will be rivers flowing of milk, and there will be various fruits. It will be a place which is good. It even talks in several places in the Vedas, in Atharva Ved, in Rig Ved. The Vedas even speak about Nark, that is hell. The description is somewhat like fire, and it says that this fire of hell will be bad, and a person won't be able to bear the pain in hell. So the concept of hell and heaven is there, but the concept of death, birth, and death is not there anywhere in the Vedas. Because the human beings, the scholars, they could not know how could some people be born healthy, some people born with congenital defect, So because of this, we find that this concept have come about the birth, death and rebirth. Let's discuss life after death in Islam. And Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 28, don't you know that you were dead and he gave you life and then caused you to die and then we again resurrected you? Your resurrection, Allah mentioned in the Quran, is you come in this world only once and again you're resurrected. And Allah says in the Quran, in chapter 67, verse number 2, that Allazi khalaqal mauta wal hayata, it is Allah who has created death and life to test which of you is good indeed. This life is a test for the hereafter. Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Al-Imran, chapter number 3, verse number 185, Allah says that kullu nafsin zaiqatul maut, every soul shall have a taste of death. The final recompense is on the day of judgment. And those who save from the hellfire and get garden in the life, they will achieve the objective of this world. For this world is nothing but mere amusement and chattels of deception. The description of heaven is given in the Quran. It describes that there are many rivers in the heaven. There are rivers of milk and there will be various fruits. It is a very beautiful place. And Quran also describes about the hellfire. Allah says in the Quran in Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 24, about the description of hell. And if we analyze in the Quran, as compared to Hinduism, doesn't have a philosophy that life, death and life again. Because some people are born rich, some people are born poor, some people are born with health, some people with congenital defect. Allah says that this life, different people have different tests. And depending upon different tests, the life will keep on changing. Let's discuss the sixth pillar of Islam. The sixth pillar of Islam is destiny. It's Qadr. And Allah says that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has certain things destined. For example, when a person is born, where will he die, when will he be born, how will he live. Like how the questions in the examination, it keeps on changing. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has already destined how will a person be born, how will he die. And this concept is the same even in Hindu scriptures, that Almighty God has destined, he has assigned how will a human being live. This was in short the similarities between the six pillars of Iman and Hinduism. Let us discuss the various similarities between Islam and Hinduism. Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Maida, chapter number 5, verse number 19, Allah says, Ya allazina amanu, O you believe, innamal khamru wal maisaru, most certainly intoxicants gambling, wal anzabul aslamu, dedication of stone, divination of arrows, rishtam nimil shaitan, these are Satan's handiwork, fashtanibul alakum tuflihun, abstain from this handiwork that you may prosper. Allah says that intoxicant, gambling, divination of arrows, all these are Satan's handiwork, abstain from it that you may prosper. Let's analyze what do the Hindu scriptures have to say about these things. If you read, it's mentioned in Manusmriti, chapter number 9, verse number 235. It says that a person who is a priest killer, who is a liquor drinker, and who is a person who lies on the marriage bed of the guru, and who's a thief, all of them do major sins. And in Manusmriti, chapter number 9, verse number 238, it says that all of these should be punished. And it says that these people, no one should talk to them, no one should sacrifice for them, no one should marry them, and all of these people should leave all the religion and should wander in the world. They should be excommunicated. That means anyone who has intoxicants, according to Manusmriti, they should wander in the world and they should be excommunicated from all the religions. It is more strict than Islam. And if you read the Hindu scriptures, intoxicants had been prohibited in several places. If you read Manusmriti, chapter number 11, verse number 55, it says that a person who drinks and a person who kills the priest, who steals, and who sleeps on the marriage bed of the guru, all of them, all those who associate with them, all of them are major sinners. It's further mentioned that alcohol has been prohibited in Hindu scriptures in several places, including Manusmriti, chapter number 7, verse number 47, Manusmriti, chapter number 7, verse number 50, in Manusmriti, chapter number 9, verse number 225, in Rig Veda, book number 8, hymn number 2, verse number 12, in Rig Veda, book number 8, hymn number 21, verse number 4. In several places, the Hindu scriptures, they prohibit the having of intoxicants. Even gambling has been prohibited in Hindu scriptures. In Rig Veda, book number 10, hymn number 34, verse number 3, it says that a person who gambles, his wife, he is left aloof, and his mother, they hate the gambler, and no one supports him. It's further mentioned in Rig Veda, book number 10, hymn number 34, verse number 13, it says that do not play with the dice, rather you should do farming. If you do farming, even if you earn less money, it will be good for the hereafter. If you analyze the Hindu scriptures, they forbid for a person to gamble. It's mentioned in Manusmriti, chapter number 7, verse number 50, it says that a person who drinks, the person who gambles, a person who indulges with women and hunting, all of them, they are the most 4 major crimes that a person can do. Gambling has been prohibited in several places. In Manusmriti, chapter number 7, verse 47. In Manusmriti, chapter number 9, verse number 221 to 228. It's also mentioned in Manusmriti, chapter number 9, verse number 258. The Hindu scriptures also prohibit fortune telling. As Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Maida, chapter number 5, verse number 90. Ya allazeena amanu, O you believe, innamal khamru wal maisuru, most certainly intoxicants and gambling, wal anzabu wal aslamu, dedication of stones, divination of arrows, rishtum min amli shaitan, these are Satan's handiwork, fashtanibu lakum tuflihun, abstain from this handiwork that you may prosper. Gambling has been prohibited. Besides gambling and alcohol, even fortune telling has been prohibited. It's also prohibited in Manusmriti, chapter number 9, verse number 258, that all those who do fortune telling, they are doing a sin. And verse number 262 says that king should punish them according to the severity of their crime. Allah also says in Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 188. Allah says, use not your wealth as a bait for judges, in order you may eat other people's wealth. Bribing has been prohibited in the Quran. Even the Hindu scriptures, in Manusmriti, chapter number 9, verse number 258, that all those who bribe, all those who deal in fraud, all of them are major sinners. And the punishment is mentioned in Manusmriti, chapter number 9, verse 262, that the king will punish them depending upon the severity of the crime. Furthermore, Islam believes in polygamy. And Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Nisa, chapter number 4, verse number 3, Allah says that marry women of your choice in twos, threes or fours, but if you can't do justice, marry only one. Quran is the only religious book which says marry only one. There is no other religious scripture on the face of the earth which says marry only one. All the other major religious scripture, if you read, no religious scripture says marry only one. If you read the Hindu scriptures, if you read Ramayana, it says that King Dashrath, the father of Ram, he had more than one wife. It's mentioned in Vishnu Sutra, chapter number 24, verse number 1, that a Brahmin can have 4 wives. If you read Mahabharat, Krishna, how many wives he had? Krishna had 16,108 wives. So if Krishna can have 16,108 wives, so why can't we Muslims have up to 4? If you analyze, the Hindu scriptures say a Hindu can marry as many wives as they want. It is the Indian government which has put a limitation. The Indian government has passed a law in 1956 called as the Hindu Marriage Act, and says that the Hindu can only marry one wife. But the Hindu scriptures say that the Hindus can marry as many wives as they want. There's no upper limit. But the Indian government has put up a limit that they can only marry one. If you read the report of the Indian government of the status of women, it's mentioned on page number 66 and 67. It gives the statistics of the polygamous marriages done in a span of 10 years, from 1951 to 1961. And the Muslims have done 4.31% of polygamous marriages. And the Hindus have done 5.06% polygamous marriages. The reasons for polygamy have been mentioned in my cassette on women's rights in Islam. This was in brief regarding the similarities between Hinduism and Islam. You can keep on talking for us together and for the complete day. But if we analyze, because of the British rule, we find that Hinduism has gone down. And especially the Britishers, they came to India to do business and they changed many of the religious beliefs of the Hindus. That's the reason late towards the 18th century and 19th century, there was a surge of Hindu reformers. And the pioneer among the Hindu reformers was the person by the name Raja Ram Mohan Roy. Raja Ram Mohan Roy, he was from Bengal and he was born in 1772. And he preached that you should believe only in one God, should not do idol worship. He was against the caste system. And he wrote a book in 1803. He learned Persian, English as well as Arabic. And in that book, he condemned idol worship. He said he does not even agree in the avatar. And he started a new trust by the name of Brahma Samaj. And this Brahma Samaj, in the trust deed, he writes that no sculpture, no graven image, no picture, no painting, no photograph should enter the building. And later on, there were many offshoots of the Brahma Samaj. And all of them, they had the common teachings that Almighty God is one. He has got no images. There are no idols of Almighty God. Almighty God has got no avatar. They were against idol worship. And regarding believing in the cycle of birth, death, and rebirth, this was optional. If you want, you can believe. If you don't want, you don't believe. The other great reformer, which was offshoot of Brahma Samaj, was Justice Ranade. Justice Ranade, he was the person who started the Prarthana Samaj. I hope you are aware of Prarthana Samaj. Are you aware of Prarthana Samaj? Very good, you are aware of Prarthana Samaj. How many of you know about Justice Ranade? How many of us? This person, he started an offshoot of Brahma Samaj and he even preached against caste system. He even preached that the widows, the women, they should remarry. He even preached that the women should be educated. The other great reformer among the Hindu was Swami Dayanand Saraswati. He started in 1875 the Arya Samaj, and the three Pandits, they are from Arya Samaj. What he said, that we should strictly follow the Vedas and we should not follow anything but the Vedas. Believe in one God, that you should not do idol worship, should not believe that God has got avatar. He started the Arya Samaj. We even have one more famous reformer by the name of Swami Vivekananda. He was the founder of Sri Ramakrishna Mission. And he said that Hinduism is a misnomer. We should call the followers as Vedantists. And he made Hinduism common to the Western world, where he gave a talk in Chicago in the Parliament of Religion. We find that many Hindu reformers were there. They tried to improve the teachings of Hinduism. And today we come to know from history that the Britishers, they had come to India to do business. They came to India about a few centuries back. They came for doing business, but they looted our country. They even ruled our country. And these Britishers, they changed the religious belief of the Indians. And these people, they saw to it that they changed the philosophy of Hinduism. So we find a surge of Hindu reformers, especially in the late 18th century and the 19th century. For example, as I mentioned, Raja Ram Mohan Roy, example of Vivekananda, example of Swami Dayanand Saraswati, Justice Anade. And these people, they were reformers. And people may wonder that all these things that I mentioned in my talk about the facts of Hinduism that I mentioned, they weren't concoction. But I received all these guidance about Hinduism from these great reformers like Raja Ram Mohan Roy and Justice Anade. And after I read this book, these people are great scholars. I am just a student of comparative religion. I am not a scholar. When I read the books of these scholars, I being a student of comparative religion, I don't take anything for granted. Whatever they said, I checked up whether are they available in the sacred scripture of the Hindus. And after verifying them, I have mentioned the facts of Hinduism while quoting the references of the Hindu scriptures. And all the facts I mentioned about Hinduism, I have also mentioned the references from the Vedas as well as the other scriptures like Upanishads, like Bhagavad Gita, etc. Those Hindus who strictly believe in the Vedas, they don't believe in any other scripture of Hinduism. So even if you remove all the other references of the Hindu scriptures, whatever references I've given, I have quoted the Vedas as well as the other scriptures. If you remove the references of the other scriptures, yet the message of Hinduism is the same. There are other Hindus, though they believe that Veda is the most sacred among the Hindu scriptures, but they even believe in the other scriptures and they more commonly read Bhagavad Gita, etc. That's the reason I've even quoted the Vedas, even the other Hindu scriptures. I have been enlightened by the great reformers of Hinduism. And from history, we have come to know that the Britishers, they ruled India by having a philosophy of divide and rule. With this philosophy, they ruled India for several years. We, alhamdulillah, more than 50 years back, we have got the freedom of this country from the rule of the British. But unfortunately, we yet continue following the philosophy of the Britishers of divide and rule. And we have examples that most of the Indian politicians, they follow the philosophy of the Britishers and they have the philosophy of divide and rule for the vote banks. And we find that in this country of ours, the maximum riots in any country of the world, it's in India. And the cause that these politicians, they instigate these riots. They follow the philosophy of divide and rule. And many people say that the politicians, they add fuel to the fire. I disagree. The politicians of India, they don't add fuel to the fire. These people, they add fire to the fuel. We know that the fuel is used for constructive work, for vehicles, for factories, for upliftment of India. But these people, they add fire to the fuel and they cause the destruction of India. All the politicians aren't like that. But most of them, they add fire to the fuel and they use it as a vote bank. Most of them, if not all, irrespective whether they're Hindu politicians, Muslim politicians, or Christian politicians. And there was an article which came in the Times of India a few weeks back. It said that according to Japan, in the next 20 years, India will be a superpower. And it's my humble request to my dear Hindu brothers, to my dear Muslim brothers, to my dear politicians of this great country of India, it's my humble request that you people, you should understand, you should follow the sacred scriptures, go back to the sacred scriptures of Hinduism and of Islam. And if we follow our sacred scriptures, inshallah, God willing, in the next 20 years, India will be a superpower. India will be better than America and the European countries. It's clearly mentioned. It's clearly mentioned in Rig Veda, book number 10, hymn number 71, verse number 4. It's mentioned that seeing the word you see not, hearing the word you hear not. You hear the word of Almighty God, but you hear not. You see the word of Almighty God, but you see not. Allah says in the Quran in Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 44. Allah says that you read the scriptures, but why don't you follow it? Allah says in the Quran in Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 18, Summum, Bukmun, Umyun, Firmla, Arjun, the deaf, the dumb, the blind, they will never do the true path. And we find that the religious personalities of most of the major religions, they prevent the followers from reading the scriptures. The religious leaders, whether they be Hindus, Muslims or Christians, they prevent the followers of the religion to read the scripture with understanding. And I've given a talk on Al-Quran, should it be read with understanding? And I proved there that the Quran was revealed so that a person should understand the revelation of Almighty God and follow the commandments of Almighty God. The best is to understand Arabic as a language. If you can't understand Arabic as a language, read the translation of the Quran in the language you understand the best. And today we find that even though there are various sects in the religion of Islam, there are minor differences, but the major principles of the various sects in Islam, it is the same. All the various different sects of Islam, they believe that there is one God. They believe that the Quran is the last and final revelation of God. They believe in the last and final messenger. It's the same. There may be minor differences, but the major pillars are the same. And if we analyze the reason that even though Islam has been divided into different sects, the major teachings are the same, because Quran was revealed in Arabic. And Arabic is a living language. There are several hundreds of millions of people who know Arabic as a language. Because of this, because the Quran was revealed in Arabic, no one can change the main teachings of Quran. A great critic of Islam, Sir William Moore, he says, though he's a critic of Islam, he says that Quran is the only book which has remained pure for 12 centuries. He mentioned this 200 years back. And today, Quran is a book which has remained pure for 14 centuries. If you go back to the scriptures, you understand. If you follow the main scriptures, if you understand Arabic, understand the language which you understand the best, the principles are the same. It's my humble request to the Indian government. It's my humble request to my Hindu brothers that you should revive Sanskrit. The Indian government and my Hindu brothers, they should revive the Sanskrit language. Today, Sanskrit is a dead language. You should revive the Sanskrit language and understand the scripture of Hinduism. If you understand the scripture of Hinduism, you will realize that your scripture and the Islamic scripture, they speak about the same one God. They believe in the same message and the last final messenger, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. They believe about the resurrection, about life after death. I would like to end my talk with the verse of the glorious Quran of Surah Yunus, chapter number 10, verse number 108, which says, Kul ya ayyuhan nas kat ja'akumul haqqu min rabbikum. Say, O humankind, truth has arrived from the Lord. Those who receive guidance, they are on the straight path. And those who go astray, they will be on the wrong path. And I have not been set to manage your affairs. Wa akhir da'wana alhamdulillah rabbil alameen.